By now, you should have a pretty good idea how to run a batch job on Biowulf. You start by writing a batch script, then you submit it to the batch system using sbatch, and you repeat as needed. You might have a need to run groups of batch jobs, perhaps with different input data or different parameters, and you might need to do that over and over again. And many Biowulf users need to submit very large groups of similar jobs that are independent, so that they can all run simultaneously. Here are some examples. You might want to process 1,000 images with AFNI, or you might want to run BLAST on several hundred query sequences, or you might want to align a large number of genome fragments against a particular genome dataset. It would be really tedious to generate, edit, or modify 1,000 individual batch scripts. And chances are you'd make a lot of mistakes. Luckily, the Slurm batch system has a built-in way of submitting a large number of similar jobs, and that's called job arrays. Job arrays are intended for a group of independent jobs that are largely identical. For a job array, you write only one batch script, and this is what, here's an example of what one might look like. It starts with the pound bang bin bash, meaning it's a bash script, CDs to some directory, and then it runs an application called Top Hat. The inputs for Top Hat would normally be a FASTQ file, and it would write into some output file. But here, instead of the name of the input file, you see it's replaced by $slurm-array-task-id.fastq, and the output file is similarly replaced by $slurm-array-task-id.out. You would submit such a script with sbatch dash dash array equals a starting index ID and an ending index ID. So here it's going from 0 to 31, meaning there's a total of 32 array indices, and the name of this batch script. Each of the subjobs is assigned an array index going from 0 to 31 in this case. And when the batch system starts up each subjob on the allocated resources, this environment variable, $slurm-array-task-id, is set to the index for that subjob. So when the first subjob runs, that's subjob 0, the command that would be run would be top hat genome index 0.fastq, and it'll write to an output file called 0.out. The second subjob would be running top hat genome index 1.fastq, and it would write to a file called 1.out. If you run S jobs, this is what a job array would look like. It would have a single job ID, underscore, and the starting and ending index of the array, 0 to 31 in this case. You can see that job arrays can be powerful. You write one batch script and you can use it to run a large number of subjobs. But there are a lot of limitations to job arrays. For example, your input files are unlikely to be named 0.fastq, 1.fastq, and so on. So either you'd have to rename all your input files or you'd have to change the script to deal with this the actual file names of your input files. Likewise, you probably don't want your output files to be called 0, 1, 2, and so on. And so to get a single batch script to represent the actual file names of your input files and output files, you need to do some careful scripting. Besides this, most batch systems have some kind of limitations on the array index and the number of tasks and so on. So that brings us to Swarm. Swarm is a utility developed in-house for the Biowulf cluster. That's a flexible and convenient way to submit large numbers of independent, similar jobs. With Swarm, instead of writing a batch script and submitting it to the batch system with sbatch, you write a Swarm command file and use the Swarm utility to submit it to the batch system. This is what a Swarm command file looks like. It has a series of lines, each line corresponding to one command that you want run. So this swarm command file has a total of 7 lines, and it will create a swarm with 7 subjobs. You can also have comment lines, which are ignored by the swarm program. And you submit it to swarm with swarm-f and the name of the swarm command file. What swarm does is it creates a subjob for each line in your swarm command file, and then it submits them as a single job array to the batch system, slurm. You get one job ID regardless of the number of commands, and each subjob is identified by the underscore task ID. So they all have the same job ID, but they would be underscore 0, underscore 1, underscore 2, and so on. Here's a little animation to show you how swarm works. Here's your swarm command file. This one has 4 commands. It's running the same program with 4 different parameters and 4 different output files. When you submit this with swarm-f and the name of this command file, it divides it into lines corresponding to each subjob. So you'd get 4 subjobs. Here's your cluster. It contains a bunch of nodes. This is supposed to represent 2 cores, 4 cores, and 8 cores on a node, and some parts of the cluster are busy. So the swarm program creates batch scripts out of your swarm command file. One batch script for each line in your swarm command file. And it submits them to the batch system as a job array. The batch system will then find the appropriate resources on the cluster and start up the jobs when possible, just as it would for any other batch job. And so you have 4 commands, that is 4 lines in your swarm command file, and you end up with one batch job with 4 subjobs. Let's take the simplest possible case, a swarm of single-threaded processes. That means each process requires only one CPU. And let's say it requires less than 1.5 gigabytes per process. You could submit the swarm of jobs with swarm-f swarm file, the name of the swarm command file. And remember, the batch system allocates by core. A core is 2 CPUs. So the batch system would allocate 2 CPUs for each process, that is each line in your swarm command file, and 1.5 gigabytes, which is the default amount of memory per process for a swarm job. Suppose each of your processes required more than 1.5 gigabytes of memory, you could specify that with the dash G flag to swarm. So you'd say swarm dash G and the number of gigabytes that each process required, dash F and the name of your swarm command file. And as before, swarm would allocate one core, that is 2 CPUs for each process, and the requested G gigabytes per process. Now, this is a swarm of single-threaded processes, so they're going to use one CPU per process, but the batch system allocates you 2 CPUs per process. That means that half the CPUs allocated for each swarm are going to sit idle. And that's okay if it's a small swarm. For example, if you have a swarm with 10 subjobs, you'll have 10 CPUs sitting idle. Don't worry about it. But suppose you have a swarm of 1,000 subjobs. That means the batch system allocates 2,000 CPUs and 1,000 of them are sitting idle. In that case, you might want to increase your processing throughput by using all the CPUs allocated to you, by packing the processes 2 per core. And you can do that with the dash P flag. By default, dash P means pack 1 process per core, but you can set it to dash P2, which means pack 2 processes onto each core. And then when you submit a swarm of jobs, all the CPUs will be used. You could also have a swarm of multi-threaded processes, where each process is going to run a certain number of threads. Now, if you remember from the earlier videos, you want the number of CPUs allocated to match the number of threads that your process is going to run. So you're going to run T threads on T T CPUs for each process, and say you want some amount of memory, G gigabytes per process. You would submit the swarm with swarm-T, and then the number of threads that you want to run per process, dash G, and the amount of gigabytes of memory, again, per process, and the dash F and the name of the swarm command file. The batch system will allocate T CPUs per process, rounded up to the nearest two, because it always allocates by twos, and G gigabytes per process. If you didn't specify the number of gigabytes of memory that you wanted, the default memory allocation would be T times 1.5 gigabytes for each process. And as before, you want to use the $slurm CPUs per task variable to specify the number of threads, so that the number of threads is always the same as the number of allocated CPUs. So here's an example running a program called MapSplice. This is a swarm command file. So it has a series of lines, one corresponding to each subjob that will be run. And each line has the dash P flag, which for MapSplice determines the number of threads. And that dash P flag is set to $slurm CPUs per task. You might have auto-threading processes, where each process is testing the node to see how many CPUs are available on that node, and it'll spawn off as many threads as there are CPUs. In that case, you use the dash T auto flag, which is guaranteed to give you a node with at least 32 CPUs for each process, that is each line in your swarm command file. So to summarize, the swarm command creates a single job array with one a job ID and the number of subjobs that corresponds to the number of commands in your swarm command file. Swarm expects bash syntax, so if you have environment variables being set in your swarm command file, you do that in bash syntax. And of course, if you have very long swarm command files with thousands of lines, thousands of subjobs, you would want to write a script to create that swarm command file, so it's less likely to have errors. If you have complex commands where you want each process to run a series of commands, you can separate that by semicolons on the line. So here's an example where each subjob will cd to some directory, run some command, and then run some other command. And so you can use the continuation character to make long lines readable by humans. You must remember that each line, each set of commands, should be completely independent. If you want to use modules in your swarm scripts, and you probably will, you can specify the modules that you want loaded on the swarm command line. So you would say swarm-f swarm file dash dash module and the name of the module that you want loaded. And so swarm will then load this module before each of these commands are run in each subjob. If you choose, you can also load the module within your swarm command file that by separating the module load command with a semicolon from the actual executable command that you're running in that subjob. But remember that module load command needs to be on each line in your swarm command file, because each of these lines is going to become a separate subjob. And then you would submit it with swarm-f and the name of your swarm file. And lastly, to delete a swarm, use scancel just as you do for any other batch job. To delete the entire swarm, you simply need to give it the job ID that corresponds to this job array. Or if you wanted to delete a specific subjob, say _13, you would say scancel the job ID _13.